sorry. We've got an hour we can use.
Okay.
And then I'll tell them that you're going to talk about yourself. My name is David Lowance, and I'm here with Henry Howell at the Atlanta History Center in Atlanta, Georgia, as part of the Library of Congress World War II Veterans Oral History Project. We have the privilege today to have with us Mr. Robert Paul Tracy and his wife Cindy. Robert was born in Illinois in 1920, grew up there and entered the service sometime later, and he's going to tell us what it was like to grow up in Illinois during the Depression time and where he was on Pearl Harbor Day and how he got into the military and what happened to him after that. Mr. Tracy, thank you so very much for being with us, and it's all yours.
Well, I appreciate your inviting me. Again, I say I don't know how much I can contribute to this.
Go ahead.
Born in Springfield, Illinois, and we moved to Moline, Illinois, back at the end of the Depression. Graduated from high school in Moline in 1938, and got a job as an usher at the local theater. Had paper routes, typical kind of growing up. Made money those days. And eventually ended up working with the local newspaper, the Moline Daily Dispatch. Was very fortunate to have a good friend that pushed me along in the classified advertising department, and I eventually ended up in the display advertising department. And it was a lot of fun. I seemed to have a talent for layout and advertising concepts and that type of thing. So it was a very enjoyable job, and they paid me for it. And along the line, in about 1939-40, met a girl and married her, and we eventually had two children, and at that time it was about 1942-43, and of course the war had started after Pearl Harbor, and I was losing my buddies day by day. They were being drafted, either drafted or enlisting. So I was beginning to feel a little bit lonely. I guess I had a desire really to become drafted, to join the fight, so to speak. Pearl Harbor Day, I was having breakfast at a restaurant across the street from the newspaper office. It was a Sunday, of course. And was able to, or desirous of going across the street and reading all of the dispatches and bulletins that were coming in on the teletype machines. It was quite an experience to be in the newsroom on that particular day. So I was getting up-to-date information and becoming more and more angry, frustrated, wanted to do something, but what do you do when the country is being bombed and Pearl Harbor is being blown off the map? Anyway, I guess I eventually bugged the draft board, trying to find out when they might draft me, and they kept telling me, well, you're being deferred because you have two children. And I guess I bugged them to the extent that they decided to get rid of me, so they did decide to draft me. And so I went to Chicago, went through the physical examination tests and all that type of thing one day, and ended up at the very end of the testing, where the there was a uniformed soldier standing there who bluntly said, "Which service would you like to go into?" And I said, "Well, I've always thought I'd like to go into the submarine service." And I don't think he said, "I'm sorry," but he said, "No, you can't do that today because we're looking for infantrymen. You're going to go into the Army. You go that way instead of that way." So that's how I ended up in the United States Army, as an infantryman replacement. Which took me to Camp Blanding, Florida, for, I recall it was a 6 or 8 week basic training. It was anything but fun. It was the middle of summer. It was June, July. And I mean, those were long marches, and it was hot, and it was sandy, and miserable. I was a bad soldier. I didn't enjoy it, I mean.
What was the food like?
I beg your pardon?
What was the food like?
The food? Oh, the food was good. They fed you well, but they worked you hard. Calisthenics, long marches, lugging 40 millimeter machine guns, and it was a lot of work, a lot of hard training. Came out probably in the best shape I have ever been in my life. Could have been going downhill ever since, it seems like. Anyway, after basic training, went home for a week's visit before being shipped overseas. Left from Hampton Roads, Virginia. Don't recall the name of the ship, but it was a huge thing with thousands of troops aboard. It was so crowded, as a matter of fact, the trip going over I spent in the swimming pool of this luxury liner that had been converted. And they had put bunks into the basin of the swimming pool, which has always been kind of a joke. Anyway, an uneventful crossing, and we eventually ended up, after about 4 or 5 days, in Naples, Italy. How am I doing?
You're doing great. You're actually doing extremely well.
Did you have any idea that you were headed for Italy?
Oh yes, they told you. And I was on the deck the day we passed the Rock of Gibraltar. I was very, very thrilled to see that. Mm-hmm. And could also see the coast of Africa as we entered the Mediterranean.
I've always wondered, in the ships were so crowded, did they have times that different areas could go on deck, or could you just wander on deck anytime?
No, you were pretty well policed insofar as scheduling was concerned. You didn't have free run of the ship, right. In other words. But they did allow smoking. And I smoked heavily at the time, so. And it was a fairly pleasant journey overseas, uneventful. Food was good, learned how to like navy beans. You served them for breakfast, you know. And ended up in Italy, Naples. Coincidentally, after being in Naples for a week or so, wandering around, I was had a little bit of free time in Naples. Let me digress a little bit by saying, while I was working for the newspaper in Moline, I always had my hair cut by a barber who had a barber shop across the street from the newspaper office. Now, when I get to Italy, I'm wandering around the streets of Naples, and who do I run into but my barber who had been drafted 6 months before. Talk about a coincidence.
Small world.
So I got a haircut, free haircut.
What month of that was in 1944?
Let's see, that was in November.
In November.
Of 43 or 44?
44. So I don't recall his name, but that was quite a coincidence. Anyway, the replacement company I was with was stationed or had quarters, bivouacked in quarters in Count Chiano's farm or whatever he called his estate. Count Chiano was a nephew or a son-in-law of Mussolini. And so we were there for maybe a week or so. And they got the orders, we got the orders to get ready, we were shipping out. So this was Count Giano's farm estate was just outside of Naples. So we went back into Naples by truck, boarded LCI landing craft in Naples, infantry landing craft, and took out in the Tyrrhenian Sea and went up to Leghorn and ran into that. It was a one-night trip, or overnight trip on this LCI, and there must have been about 20 or 30 of these LCIs all going up at the same time as a group. And we ran into the damnedest storm you ever seen in your life. And I thought everybody aboard the ship thought it was going to break apart. It was that rough. It was up and then all of a sudden down with a slam all night long. Everybody was sick. Anyway, we got to Leghorn. Got on trucks, went through Pisa, had a short visit in Pisa, saw the Leaning Tower of Pisa, was so thrilled to see that, we had enough time that it jumped off the truck, we all did, I guess, and ran completely to the top of it, all the way to the top. I can't do that anymore, but the Leaning Tower of Pisa, I remember it well. Back on trucks, and let's see, from there we headed toward Florence, and the 85th Division, I'd been assigned to the 85th Division, which was known as Custer's Division, 85th Division. I don't know whether it had anything to do with General Custer or not, but anyway. I've never been able to find out. But headed toward Florence, joined a large camp there. And the 85th was on a R&R, rest and relaxation, or whatever it's called. And underwent a little more training with them, was there for perhaps a month or so, really, was able to get into Florence a number of times, saw David, the statue of David, when it was still outside in the open air, that's before they built the large enclosure for it now, museum. The reason they moved him in is because the weather was starting to erode the features of his fine carving, his carving sculpture. Let me
just ask if I could.
Sure. Interrupting at any time, as a matter of fact.
Ambrose is so down on the replacement system the Army used, where people like you were just injected fairly willy-nilly into units. He was talking about the campaign in Northern Europe. How did you feel coming in as part of a replacement company and then sort of getting parceled out? Was that a...
Well, it was strange at the very beginning, but you joined a bunch of poor soldiers, infantrymen, who quickly made you feel a part of the family because they knew you were there to, as a replacement. And they made it fairly easy to integrate into their group. So there was no problem.
Didn't you say you went through Milan and saw Mussolini and his mistress?
Yeah, that was at the very end of the... It was at the very end, just before the war ended. Anyway, the 85th Division, after their short rest, moved up to the front line along a line, and I recall that it was called Mount Grandy. It was in the northern Apennines overlooking the Po Valley. And I was in an outpost, I recall, having dug my way into a foxhole, and I was an outpost at the very top of this mountain, Mount Grandy, and it was quiet during the day, but at every night the Germans would pound that entire area with artillery shells, and it made the earth, of course, tremble with every shot that went through, which was kind of a thrilling experience, wondering if the next one is going to end up in your little foxhole. I learned how to say the Lord's Prayer many times, as a matter of fact.
Yeah. How close did the shells come to where you were foxhole in?
Oh, I'd say the closest one perhaps 100 yards, 200 yards. But they were surrounding, it seemed like, sort of a ring. We were in the middle. I was in a foxhole with one other man, of course.
Had anything prepared you for the first barrage of artillery at night?
Nothing whatsoever. Well, that was quite an experience to be under fire. So the 85th Division was assigned that section on the front, and you pulled up. I pulled duty at an outpost, but every night we ran patrols where our group would platoon, I guess, is that what they were calling? I swear to God. Platoon of about 12, 15 men.
Squad.
And we'd run squad. Our squad would go out, and as the sun was setting, and we would go to different places and set up and just sit there quietly and wait, because the Germans were in the habit of infiltrating our lines, or at least trying to, so you never knew when you might be in a firefight. So, and it did happen a couple of times. Fortunately, I got out without a scratch. We beat them off. They retreated. But this went on for about 30 days, and you don't get any time off. It was every day, every night, running a patrol. And let's see.
Would you do patrols, sequential nights, or was there an attempt to rotate that duty so you didn't have that particularly hazardous task all the time?
It seemed to be almost every night the squad would go out. Of course, there were several squads in our company. Fan out and go into different areas, be assigned to different areas. But the odd thing about it was you went out to a certain point and an officer probably said, all right, this is it, so sit down and be quiet, you know, sit down and be quiet and wait. And you either were rudely awakened or rudely interrupted in your sitting, or you got off scot-free that night. So that was kind of a drag on and on.
This is during the winter.
This is during the winter, November, December.
'44.
And after about a little while, the 85th Division was again pulled back from the front line, still in the state in the northern Apennines. And it was bitter, bitter cold. Oh, God. And as we took up a position, or at least our battalion did, on a farm where really the only place you could get warm was to go into the farm's barn where there were a few head of cattle, and the warmth of these cattle warmed the barn, and so you were able to go in and get some relief from the bitter cold. The snow, ice all over the place, of course.
Did you take a bath during that 30 days?
Oh yes, you took
maybe
once a week if you're lucky. They bring in a portable kind of a situation, tent-wise, set the thing up.
They have hot water or is it cold?
Yeah, hot water.
Yeah, hot water.
So. But it seemed mostly cold.
Got any hot food?
And oh yes, hot food. I have no real complaint against the food. A lot of Spam. Pretty good cooks, the food that I had. A lot of sea ration, by the way, which you could trade off with the paisans for fruit or vegetables or anything that was different than a sea ration. So we were in this small setup on this farm, so to speak, until I guess around the middle of December, when it was decided that the division would make its push into the Po Valley, away from Mount Grandy. So we all got into trucks and went into the Po Valley and a little bit of fire, and we also had some friendly fire that made life interesting too. I remember jumping off and on trucks many times, heading for the ditches, while planes would go over, maybe strafe a little bit. Well, let's see, I'm kind of getting to the end of my recollection.
Did you come upon any really stiff resistance when you moved into Po Valley?
At first, it was very, very stiff. But they, at that period of time, they were kind of running out of people. They were running out of reserves. So you're running into extremely young soldiers, maybe as young as 14, 15 years old, and some older men in their 50s, quite possibly, that had been simply snatched off the streets and said, you're going to go to the front lines and stop the invasion of the Fifth Army up the boot of Italy.
Wind up taking a lot of prisoners and people.
Tremendous number of prisoners, and we spent a lot of time guarding those prisoners. Favorite pastime of the guards, unfortunately, were searching the prisoners and confiscating as many Leica cameras as they could find. and anything else of value that the prisoner might have. But that's war, I guess. As we pass through, as we were going through the Po Valley, of course, the Po River was there. And we had previously taken river crossing in the Arno River near at Florence, where we practiced crossing the river by carrying a rifle over your head and actually wading across the river. We did the same thing with the Po River.
Oh, in December?
It was extremely cold.
Whoa.
And so you got across as quickly as possible. But you carried your best friend, the rifle, over your head and kept it dry. That was getting into... date-wise, about April of 1945, and things were kind of running down, so to speak, as we progressed toward the Brenner Pass, which is in northeastern part of Italy. But before we got there, we had to go through Milan, and that's when Cindy reminded me as we went through Milan, and this was just about at the very day that the war ended almost, they had caught Mussolini, and I saw Mussolini hanging upside down in front of what I thought was a theater, but I'd been told it was a post office, but he and his mistress were hanging upside down in front of this building, and I only remember seeing it fleetingly as we went by from the back of a truck. Didn't get to stay.
Yeah.
So we headed on up to the Brenner Pass, and really that's just about when the war ended. May 1st, I believe it was, or 2nd or 3rd, 7th, I want to say. And as we were running out of resistance at all, we were able to move without any trouble at all. So it was quite an experience. I had a lot of fun after the war was over. Went to Venice a number of times. My favorite city, Venice. And Florence, of course.
Got to stay over there how long before you came back?
Let's see, I was over there, came back in November of 45, so I was over there for a good 6 or 8 months.
And was that because they simply didn't have the transport capacity to get that many people back quickly?
Well, at the end of the war, they had a point system. And those who had been over there for a number of months, for a long period of time, were plucked out and able, if they had enough points, they were sent home. I did not have enough points to immediately leave, but eventually I left in November, I believe, October, November, left through Naples, a big celebration, what came back was the 34th Division, which was a fighting Irish division, I guess. It was a well-decorated division. And General Mark Clark, who was the commander of the 5th Army, gave us a farewell and a thank you speech there at the boat dock as we pulled out. It was and the bands were playing and the people were screaming and yelling. It was a very thrilling experience to go through. Came back on the same ship that I went over on. and I can't remember the name of it, but it had been a luxury liner that had been converted. This time I didn't have to sleep in the swimming pool.
Was it as crowded coming back, or did they
take it a little easier? It didn't seem to be as crowded, and aboard ship there were a number of Italian war brides.
Ah!
Not bad.
Did you get mail from your bride when you were...
V-mail, yes.
V-mail? On a regular basis?
Pretty regular, yeah. It's hard to read. I didn't write nearly as much as I should have, but...
Did you get pictures of your children while you were over there?
Oh, that's a point that I'd forgotten. No, I did not. But, let's see, it was in January of 1945. I was advised that I had became a father for my third child. The American Red Cross called me out. Said that you have a new daughter that had been born. So
this is while you were on the front lines up at
the front line in January of 1945.
45. 45. Yeah. Very exciting. Very exciting.
How did you celebrate?
I think they drank a little bit extra wine that day, you know. Yeah, as a matter of fact, enjoyed their vino, even their miserable, chaotic. I enjoyed their wine.
Were the Italian people glad to see you when you were fighting up into the northern part of Italy?
Yeah. We ran into a number of what they call themselves, paisanos, which were
partisans.
Partisans. That's right. And. They were armed, and they helped the Allied push through the boot also. But they were glad to see the Germans go. And the Italian people, I love the Italian people. My memory of them, very favorable.
You were still in Italy when the atom bomb was dropped. What was your reaction over there when you heard about that, and do you remember?
Well, I guess, hooray, the war's got to be over, maybe. You know? It's about the only, I don't remember any extra celebration that we went through, but...
Did you think you might be headed for the Pacific at that point?
There was a rumor going around that we were going to be transferred to the Pacific. That was, of course, before the bomb was set off. Another very sad thing at that time was the death of Franklin Delano Roosevelt. And when the day he died, there were a lot of sorrowful people saying, my God, our leader is gone, and how can we possibly carry on without FDR? So he was loved by the troops, there's no kidding about that.
When you got out of the service, did you take advantage of the GI Bill for education or anything?
No, never took advantage of anything. I was so glad to get out.
What'd you do with your civilian life after you got out?
Went back to the newspaper.
Back in Moline?
Back in Moline. Picked up where I started, where I left off. And, I was mustered out of the Army. I was discharged at Rockford, Illinois.
Close by.
I was inducted through Chicago at the Sheridan, not the Sheridan, at the what's the name of that? Anyway, it was a large induction center in Chicago. What am I missing?
What was your reaction when you got back and saw your new child?
Well, of course, you can imagine how how thrilled I was.
Yeah.
But I was impressed the American Red Cross got the message through that. That's about the only thing I could say nice about the American Red Cross. Our Salvation Army was a different story.
How so?
Well, they seemed to be more caring. The Red Cross was, well, they charged for coffee, as a matter of fact, the Red Cross. Salvation Army was free. Red Cross officials seemed to be a little standoffish. They were awfully friendly with the officers, but beyond that, it seemed to me that they were a little bit cold to the down and dirty doughboys.
Did they run canteens in Italy?
Oh yes.
No, we don't know. As did the Salvation Army.
As did the Salvation Army.
Didn't know that. So. The war's over. You're up in northeast Italy. And you didn't know it at the time, but you're going to be there a long time. What did the army do with you and people like you for nearly 6 months before you got home?
They made it really pretty easy. They encouraged visiting. A lot of the soldiers like me went to Switzerland for visits. I pretty much went to Venice whenever I had a chance, because I loved the city so. But it was kind of a boring time, and there was not any formal training that was taking place. It was just kind of an interim period where nothing was happening, really.
Where would they house you?
Different public buildings, universities. Really? We spent some time in the University of Naples.
And did they expect you to show up for muster or?
Oh, yeah.
Every day, or did they?
Yeah, you just couldn't wander around.
Yeah, so you showed up at 8 or 9 or whatever it was in the morning, and then what'd you do?
You got up at the time you're supposed to get up, and if you didn't have any kind of a duty, then they used to dream up duties that you could fill your time in with. You were free to go into the city. In Naples, for an example, I went to Naples and to
Pompeii.
Went into Pompeii a number of times. I regret I didn't go to Capri like a number of soldiers did.
Things could have been a lot worse, couldn't they?
Could have been a lot worse. It was kind of a nice thing after the war was over.
After the war was over.
Bob, you entered the service in part because you said all of your friends were being drafted and taken away, and you felt a duty to go or got lonely or whatnot.
And I guess maybe I wanted to get away from my wife. I don't know.
Is that true?
Not his wife.
No, that was my first wife. Cindy's my second wife.
What lessons did you learn in World War II that you think would be worthwhile to? Or did you learn any lessons? Were you just doing your job?
No, I didn't really learn anything that I feel as though it could be passed on to help someone live. When you're a replacement infantryman, you kind of are a little tiny cog in a great big machine, and you just do whatever you need to do and stay out of the way so you don't get hurt. So you don't have an opportunity or have a desire really to learn too much. It wouldn't do you any good anyway.
Well, learning how to make a big wheel operate is a little small part of it. It's an important lesson for a lot of people to learn.
Well, that's true. That's true. It's a small cog, big operation. One of millions that went through it as I did.
If there weren't a lot of small cogs like yourself, people like me and Henry wouldn't have been able to go to school over here in Eat Rivers and this Bloodworth Kindergarten.
We sure wouldn't be sitting in Atlanta, Georgia, that's for sure.
He's always talking about we have a couple of standard poodles that are really bad to sort of put a guilt trip on you at mealtime. And every time he says, you just like those Italian children. Oh, he didn't mention that too much about the starving children over there that he used to give his food to.
If I have been haunted by anything for 60 years, it is haunted by the Italian children that used to come and watch us at mess time, eat our food, and I can still see them going through the garbage pits almost to find food for themselves. Little kids, it brings tears to my eyes, really. But they've haunted me for 60 years. I see them every time I look at my poodles.
Did the military do anything to try and help the Italian population, or were you too busy being soldiers?
If they did, I didn't see.
As it was the worst winter in, they said, 50 years. And on top of that, you had a country that had been absolutely torn up by the war.
You can't imagine how that country was torn up. I didn't think they'd ever put it back together again. And cold never have been as cold as I was when we were just below Florence, I believe it was, just before we went through the Po Valley. God, it was cold. That cattle barn sure felt nice.
Yeah.
Bob, is there anything else you'd like to tell us? Henry and I would like to express our sincere appreciation to you and your generation for what you've done for us. You may not think you did much, but we would take issue with that. And we're honored to have you with us today. And
well, thank you very much again for asking me. Hope you can use what I've told you for whatever it might be worth.
It's worth a great deal.
But you got another perspective. We really appreciate it. And Cindy, thank you for